Hey guys, Janus here. Today I'd like to talk about a process that is absolutely crucial to our discussion of male sexual organ growth, known as arteriogenesis and monocyte adhesion. Arteriogenesis, in its most basic terms, is the muscularization of vascular pathways via smooth muscle migration and proliferation. In order to help everyone get a better grasp on the topic, I'm going to lay out from start to finish as straightforward of an explanation as possible. The very first thing that occurs in the process of arteriogenesis is increased shear stress. Whenever blood rushes through the central channel of a blood vessel, the glycocalyx growing upon the surface of endothelial cells that live along its walls begin to blow about like grass in a field. This stimuli is felt by endothelial cells, and they begin releasing explosive bursts of nitric oxide, which first encourages endothelial cell relaxation before smooth muscle relaxation. Imagine one tube expanding inside another. As endothelial cells relax, the accessory channels leading out into the blood vessel walls dilate, causing a sudden influx of nitric oxide into the outer portions of the walls where the smooth muscle lives, thus causing smooth muscle relaxation secondarily, greatly increasing the internal diameter of the channel. The events beyond this point are predicated upon the idea that the level of blood flow passing through the central channel of a given blood vessel is still too great for its current size/distensibility and is exerting an unacceptably high level of shear stress. As time passes and the blood vessel continues to experience this heightened level of shear stress, the endothelial cells along its central channel begin undergoing changes in cellular expression. One of these important changes is an increase in adhesion protein expression. As this process gets underway, monocytes floating in our bloodstream pass over these areas of increased adhesion, stick to them, and then begin exerting effects locally upon the surrounding cells, while also simultaneously invading the extracellular space. One of these effects that the monocyte will exert as it's invading this extracellular space is an increase in proteinases, which helps break down the pre-existing extracellular matrix while also upregulating extracellular matrix growth factors. During this event, smooth muscles begin undergoing an increased amount of distension/stretch as they bear more and more of the circumferential strain caused by the rushing blood due to the breakdown of the extracellular matrix. This increased circumferential strain causes smooth muscle-based proliferation that will continue until the extracellular matrix is fully restored. However, before the extracellular matrix restoration occurs, a few intriguing events transpire that results in the outward remodeling of a blood vessel. While the extracellular matrix is broken down, some smooth muscles will undergo a phenotype switch and begin to migrate towards the central channel of a blood vessel so as to expose themselves to the potent mitogens being released by the endothelial cells. Upon exposure, they begin to proliferate. As these affected smooth muscles begin to multiply, another important step occurs either simultaneously or not long after, which helps to outwardly redirect these smooth muscles as to cause an outward remodeling of the blood vessel and therefore a wider diameter. While the blood vessel wall is in flux, the endothelial cells along the central channel begin increasing vascular endothelial growth factor, VEGF for short, which makes its way into the outer walls of the blood vessel via the endothelial tubule channels. It is in these outer channels that nitric oxide production by the endothelial cells skyrockets upon exposure to the VEGF, further increasing dilation and shear stress exposure felt by these accessory channels. This increase in nitric oxide, growth factors, and chemoattractants causes the increasing number of smooth muscle cells to then migrate outwardly into the outer rings of the blood vessel and away from the central channel. In this way, the blood vessel is able to grow from the inside out and away from its center. If we take into consideration the tenets of arteriogenesis and then compare them to endothelial cell migration that takes place during angiogenesis, we find that the lesson regarding smooth muscles following endothelial cells still holds true. More than likely, the latticework formed by endothelial cells acts very much like tracks might for a train, or, just as likely, similar to a scent trail for a bloodhound. From what I can tell, smooth muscles either migrate along the outer surface of endothelial cell tubules or through their central channels, hence why so many forms of cancer therapy involve actively interfering with processes like endothelial cell migration, proliferation, and tubule formation. Without endothelial cell-based latticeworks of tubules, cancer growths would have a much more difficult time forming larger feeding vascular channels, but I digress a little bit from the topic. Getting back on topic, in either case, my studies regarding arteriogenesis has, for more than a few reasons, revived a little fascination of mine. I have wondered more than a few times if smooth muscles, once they have undergone a phenotype switch, are able to pass through our vascular walls and into our bloodstream and attach elsewhere in areas releasing specific chemical signals. My curiosity only grows stronger when we consider endothelial cells have been shown to detach themselves from the vascular wall, float in our bloodstream, and attach elsewhere. Honestly, what better way to build new vascular pathways than taking advantage of blood flow, like seeds being swept along in the tide destined for distant shores? We know that our bodies, even as adults, can produce stem cells and that they travel through our bloodstream, but in my research I've come across an exceptional amount of evidence suggesting pre-differentiated building blocks existing near or within similar cell stratas. An example would be endothelial progenitor cells and smooth muscle progenitor cells. We know from the research centering around healing that these cells can detach and do travel to sites of injury. But what causes their formation? Looking at the research, we know that growth factors released during stimulation of our vascular network, say during exercise, also travels throughout our bloodstream and can exert system-wide effects. Taking an educated guess, these very same growth factors, within reason, may play a pivotal role in the increased production of progenitor cells from the vascular wall, which would then detach and travel throughout our circulatory system. In short, instead of relying upon stem cells for healing, the body would instead rely more heavily upon autocrinal-based signaling for healing and growth. Essentially, with increased stimulation in a given area, and then subsequent activation of our entire vascular networks, we could achieve effects very, very similar to what we see in bodybuilding. My main reason for broaching this topic in the light of arteriogenesis has a great deal to do with shear stress-mediated monocyte adhesion. If we have endothelial and smooth muscle progenitor cells floating in our bloodstream, and we know that heightened shear stress through a given portion of our vascular tree increases adhesion, then this stands to reason that the key mechanism behind shear stress-based sexual organ growth may center almost entirely around progenitor cells and their generation elsewhere in the body. In short, the dynamic between shear stress, progenitor cells, growth factor release, and adhesion dynamics may account for the seemingly unrelated or bizarre aspects of my research, such as past notes regarding foods like the unforgivables and the tendency for activities that involve short bursts of intense cardiovascular activation to increase sexual organ size in men. Well guys, I hope you enjoyed this video and that it sparks some of your own breakthroughs. If you're a newcomer to my channel, go ahead and hit that subscribe button now, along with the bell icon to keep pace with my research. Lastly, if you have a question, go ahead and post it in the comments section below and I'll get to it later in the week. Something to keep in mind is that if your comment gets a lot of likes, I'll feature it in my Q&A series. Much love guys, and as always, I'm your host, Janus, signing off.